Welcome to StormCast, the official Warhammer Age of Sigmar podcast.
Hello, we're here to talk about the latest news from the Mortal Realms. So I think the big thing this week is that we know what's going to be available to pre-order this coming Saturday. And let's have a little talk about it, what we're excited about.
Yes, so it's all out there in the open now. It's like finally good to sort of breathe out and be like, oh, cool. Like everyone knows. There's not like, oh, you know. For me, I think the thing which I like the most is probably Malign Sorcery.
Okay.
Because I think when this was sort of on the slate, people were like, oh, the spell's going to be like in separate boxes. Like, no, it's like you get this enormous box.
You literally get a magic box.
It's a box of tricks. It's got a handle on it. Like, it's just such a big, fun set. And like the whole supplement and all the end of spells, like here's some fun stuff for your games.
Is it 13 spells?
13 spells
in that. So have you got a favorite amongst them? You're looking forward to painting first.
I think for me, like it's tricky to say. Obviously, the purple sun is awesome. I think for me, it's gonna be fun to like paint this to theme my army.
Yep.
So I'm gonna paint them all as like Brayherd versions. So So like the cogs are gonna be all sort of rusted and sort of jammed up with dirt, and like the purple sun might be sort of the color of the war paint.
Give it horns.
It's gonna be the same as everything, just with like tiny horns
and hooves and two of the little spikes.
Prismatic palisade with just little legs coming out the side.
So I think I'm gonna do the same. So I'm in the middle of doing an Ideneth army at the moment. I'm gonna kind of, a lot of them have got kind of swirling vortexes and stuff, and obviously that lends itself very well to being kind of water of some sort, which would be quite cool. Obviously we've got Soul Wars box set on the way. We're pretty excited about that. What are you going to paint up first out of yours, Rory?
I think it's definitely the Nighthaunt. Like, I think they're really, really appealing models for a lot of reasons. Where, like, I don't think painting them is going to be like doing anything else. I really want to get stuck in with that new Hexwraith Flame technical, because like, I'm quite a lazy painter. Like, I like stuff to look good, but like if you tell me,
but quickly,
Rory, you can spray an army white and wash it, I'm like, great, I'm there, I'm sold. Yeah. Cool. How about you?
So I think the one I'm most excited about painting is actually the Stormcast Ballista.
Really?
I just really like the look of it.
Yeah.
So that's probably going to be...
crew, just going to have like a little lone ballista.
I probably will paint the crew as well, but I just really like the look of kind of that lion-esque head on the front of it. It just kind of seems like that was missing for the Stormcast for me for a long time, so I'm looking forward to doing that. I think I probably will get around to painting the Nighthaunt eventually as well. I want to do them all in very dirty looking rags, I think,
rather than ghosts.
So they're kind of actual sheets that they've kind of lifted up rather than spooky greenish ones, probably, but I'll see how I feel after painting one. If it's a hassle, I might just spray them white and use the wash.
Yeah.
Cool. And then obviously we've got the General's Handbook on the way as well, which is obviously another vital addition to any gamer's library of stuff.
Yeah, it's nice. You can sort of come out the gate and start expanding your games straight away, which is pretty cool. I think obviously if you're a match player, you've got your points profiles and your battle plans in there. But like, I think most people are going to want to pick up a copy just because there's like a little bit of content for every kind of gamer in there, which is cool.
Brilliant. So that's the roundup of what's on its way this weekend. Next up, we've got the rest of the show. Hello and welcome back. We have another faction focus for you. And we're joined now by Ben, who is not only a Daughters of Khaine player, but also a member of the Warhammer studio. Ben, thank you for joining us.
You're welcome.
So Daughters of Khaine in the new edition. They're obviously one of the most recent additions to the Age of Sigmar. But what does the new edition bring for them?
The new edition brings a few things. I think, again, the lookout, sir, on your little fragile hags is really, really important and really helps them out and keeps them being able to power up those witch elf units, those sisters of slaughter's units.
So lookout, sir, is minus one to hit at range, isn't it? Because they aren't wearing a huge amount of armor.
They are not, no. Little dress, and that's about it.
Quite unlikely to deflect crossbow bolts and things like that. Yeah, okay. So this is one of those armies that was built maybe with the new edition in mind when you guys were going about making the battle tome. So is there some stuff in there that we maybe haven't seen yet, kind of its full potential, do you think?
I think the ability to use multiple command abilities is the big one. Marathi still needs to be the general to be able to utilize hers, but it means then that your slaughter queens can still then also make other units fight. So if you have enough command points either saved or you've bought those as part of your army if you're playing match play, all of a sudden if you can get that army into fight, then go again, does an awful lot of damage.
So it's one of those armies that kind of works really well with lots of combos and stuff. And we were talking a little bit about the kind of, it's already got a lot of synergy in it, but once you throw in multiple command abilities, you get a lot of scary stuff.
Yeah, I think it's like, we've already had prayers and spells, which is kind of the bread and butter. And I think like a big block of 30 witch elves is brilliant. And if you're putting like more than one, so you can have them fight twice and be boosting them another command ability, you've got rerolls to charge from one of the generic command abilities. Like, I think it's just such a toolbox of an army, and I think you've just got like more of what you love, basically.
Yeah, more synergies, which are always good. They, like you say, Rory, they are full of them.
So what do you think the big changes are going to be in terms of how people construct their army for this edition?
So I think and going back to the hags, I think adding more of those. And I think I use three big blocks of two witches, one big block of sisters, and three hags. But I think I'm the only sort of person who's running that. I think a lot of people seem to be a bit scared that they're just going to get picked off. So now that you can drop those in. I think the Slaughter Queen gets a good place as well now with that extra command ability, whereas before, I think I use one on the Cauldron of Blood as my general, and that works quite nicely.
So some of the command abilities you've got, the generic ones for the new edition, benefit the Daughters of Khaine quite a lot as well, don't they?
Yes.
So do you want to talk a little bit about what those command abilities are and how they
benefit? Yeah, so at the double is, instead of making the run roll, it just counts as a six. And when your units are already movement seven and can run and charge, you can fly across the
Seems
battlefield
pretty solid.
Really quickly, yes.
Potential first turn charge in there.
Potential first turn charge in there, yeah.
And then you've also got rerolls to charge.
Rerolls to charge, yeah, if you need it. But I think one thing that works really well with the Daughters of Khaine is just hold back just a little bit and let the blood tide...
The other one.
Blood rights table,
it's
thank
all about
you.
Blood. It's all about blood.
All about blood. Let the blood rights table just click up a couple of bars, and then you get all your rerolls, rerolling to hit as well at that point. So yeah, being able to get them straight into combat, really good.
So that's kind of a recurring theme across a lot of the armies for the new edition of Age of Sigmar, because you can kind of stack up those command points, and because a lot of abilities kind of rack up as the turns go on, basically. You probably will see more games where there's maybe a slightly more cautious first couple of turns.
Yeah, I agree. But I think what we've tried to do is change that a little bit in some of the new, particularly match play missions in the General's Handbook.
Okay, fair enough. Cool. We haven't really talked about those yet, but we'll find out about those soon, we're sure. So in terms of allies then, what do you think? We think we'll see more Daughters of Khaine in allied forces?
I think you'll see a lot of Daughters of Khaine in allied forces, because I think they're quite cheap and they can do quite an interesting job. Even just a small unit of 20 witch elves and a hag to give them witch brew is only 260 points, which is quite cheap. I think Medusas, Bloodrat Medusas, are still, again, really good value. Again, another wizard. I've talked quite a bit about how many bonuses wizards have had recently with all the endless spells. And I also think the reverse of that, I think adding in the Knight in Cantor, for example, from the StormCast into the Daughters of Khaine is a really good option.
Cool, brilliant. Well, Ben, thank you ever so much for joining
us.
We hope that the Daughters of Khaine fans out there have enjoyed your insights, and we'll be back very soon for our next segment. Hello, we are joined by Chris Peach of Warhammer TV fame, and today we're going to be talking about building an army for the new Warhammer Age of Sigmar in one of the realms.
Mm.
So, Chris, thank you ever so much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure. So, you have embarked on a new army project for the new edition. Do you want to tell us a little bit about it?
So, obviously, people may be aware of my Hallowguild army. It's an offshoot from that, so I started doing stuff from the Realm of Fire, or Akshi.
So, you've got an army already which is set in the Realm of Fire, and you've built it around a free city of your own creation?
Yeah, it's we've got Shadows of a Hammer, which I was like in two realms, isn't it? So, this is like part of Azir and part of Actually, so there's almost like you've got the two colour schemes going on. And I started adding Realm of Fire stuff a long time ago. And just recently, I've been adding Scourge Privateers because I think they look cool. I've been kit bashing because I like kit bashing. That's what I do. So I've just been making all these like pirates and stuff. And I was having a conversation with you, actually. It was a few weeks back. And I was like, oh, you know, I really want to get some of the IDNs in there. And Dermot in the team was like saying, oh, that'd be really cool to get some of those in there as well. So what I decided to do was obviously start with Scourge Privateers. We've been playing a skirmish campaign as well, which is really, really cool. And just getting like one or two IDNF models in there, kind of mimicking the colour scheme in a way as well, just so it ties in nicely. But from a background narrative point of view, these guys, the Scourge Privateers, sail the seas. And as a tithe, so they don't get killed and all their souls get taken away by the IDNF, they basically capture all different races, all different souls, and that's their tie for then hunting the seas, so they can get things like Charybdis and Hydras and all sorts of beasts that then sell off to like wizards and arenas and such like. So they're literally just like, yeah, we'll get you some souls.
It's a cool narrative. So when you're approaching a new army like this, do you have like a picture of the miniatures in your head you want to make first and then build the background around it? Or do you start with the background and kind of find your inspiration there and then build the miniatures?
I think both merge at the same time. What I tend to do is I get some bits and I start building things and go, oh, this looks cool. Oh, I could do some pirates. Oh, I could do some elf pirates. Oh, yeah, you got Scourge Privateers. Let's totally do some of those. And then just like banding my ideas around to like members in the team and stuff, then they're like, oh, that'd be really cool if you had some IDNF in. And you know, it's that it then grows and becomes a thing. So the actual background, I suppose, and the actual force grows from like the enthusiasm of others around me as well. So I don't go in going, I'm definitely going to do this today. It's like sometimes it just evolves and mutates, if you like. So, yeah.
So what's your goal for it then? Have you got like a size of army in mind that you're aiming at? Or is this just kind of like a continuous thing?
I think it'll be I have a size of army to start off with, and I've got about 30 Scourge Privateers. I've got a Fleet Master. I'm going to use another Fleet Master, but it'll be like his second in command, so it'll be like a bosun. So I've been converting using some Dark Eldar stuff as well, because they've got some really cool poses and using some of their heads. There's so much stuff you can use in our kits.
There's a lot of elf-shaped stuff. Yeah, for sure.
So just to start off, I've got like some Scourge Privateers, got some commanders, and then I'm going to add like the Fangmore Eels. So these are like the pilots that just guide them through the seas, because if they go off the beaten path, then they're going to get killed, because they shouldn't be going that direction. They should just be following these guys. Then I'll start getting some of the big sharks in there as well, and then the Achillean Leviathan, and then just like thralls, and just it will end up becoming an Ideneth army with Scourge Privateers as allies, not the other way around, like it starts in the main.
You've got quite a flexible set of tools for doing that. So you've got the Realm of Fire stuff, so you can choose which realms you're fighting and which artifacts you have. But like, I know the Iron Rack Enclave, your allies get your Tides of Death ability, so it's actually really rewarding if you play one of the kind of smaller elven factions taking Ideneth Deepkin as like your main part of the army.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I was looking at different colour schemes to pick from, and the one that just really rings out in a very similar palette to the one to my Realm of Fire stuff is it Thutan or Thuthan? I can't pronounce it. Simply unpronounceable Ideneth name, but it's just absolutely the same colour scheme. I was like, totally.
The red armoured ones, isn't it?
Yeah, not even looked at the rules yet.
All right, okay,
just went, they're going to be there.
I think they're good at charging stuff.
Yeah. Oh, that's
good. Which will fit right into normal
play. It's the only phase I worry about.
So what's going to be your kind of standard enemies for these guys? I know you play fairly regularly. What's the army these guys are going to be?
So at the moment, it'll be against Dermot and the team. He's got a load of goblins from the Realm of Death, and he's done this really clever thing where he's painted them with like white robes, so they're basically wearing like sheets over them to disguise themselves as ghosts.
Right.
So he's like, literally,
you've got to get quite a lot of goblins before the souls are worthwhile, though, haven't you?
Yeah, that you'd need 100 goblins for one thrall, I think.
Probably, yeah.
I think that's what the soul scryer.
No, it's just like you never satisfied. You're always, they're very snackable.
Snacks. So yeah, I'm just playing against him. There's Duncan as well with his Solocost free guild army. So I think I'm having a kind of a grey area order force now that can actually feel like it's right to fight him and murder his guys. And
so you started off with quite a kind of noble force, didn't you? From Azir, they already kind of repopulate the realms, and as the kind of your narrative continues, they get a little bit more
I think the Daughters of Khaine kicked that in for me. I just thought, I'm sick of tired of being a good guy, let's just start.
Sometimes
I
just want to rip someone's heart out and feed it to a goddess.
Yeah, that's totally it.
Brilliant. Well, I mean, thank you ever so much for joining us, Chris. I think that's been interesting. I hope people listening along at home have been inspired by your army. At some point, I think we'll try and find a space for it on the Warhammer community website and see if we can showcase some of your work. Just before we leave, is there any kind of unit you're particularly excited about adding?
I think the Fangmore Eels. Right. They're just the ones with the swords. There's two
Mortar
names.
Guys.
That's the ones, yeah. I just really love the helmets. Don't care about the weapon, it's just the helmet, it's all mega.
Cool. Right, well, we'll look forward to them, Chris.
Cool.
Thank you ever so much for joining us.
No worries.